it's always challenging being the talk just before lunch or the talk just after lunch. So I hope that we're gonna have a little bit of fun here. Gonna turn this into something a little different than the other machine and deep learning sessions that we heard this morning. Gonna go into a little bit of an actual use case that we had at GitHub on machine learning, on graphs of code. So you start hearing graphs, you start thinking math. Don't worry, we're not gonna go math. We're gonna have some fun with graphs. I'm not going to do the survey of who all here has heard of GitHub, but I do want to ask. I'm going to turn this into this is the audience participation portion of the program. How much data do you think GitHub stores? Just throw it out in your favorite unit of bytes. A lot? Yeah. Zettabytes? Not quite zettabytes. I heard hexabytes. I heard petabytes. Okay, petabytes, we're about there. We're at 0.8 petabytes worth of data. Okay, and today, if you take nothing else away from this presentation, I want you to be excited about the data that we have. We have an absolutely unique data set. No data set exists like this in the world. We're talking about the data of code and the data of developers. And what does that actually look like? If I were to plot it out, this is one of our more popular graphics you might see at some of our tech events. And we can talk about all of our data being a graph. Now, before you think about the graphs that like my 8-year-old is learning to draw in school, we're talking about connected data. Okay, a graph is just two things that are connected to each other. So in the world of GitHub, that might be a developer writes this bit of code. A developer pulls a pull request, makes a pull request, or creates an issue, or maybe it's this repository is cloned from this repository. Lots and lots and lots of graph data, 0.8 petabytes roughly, give or take. And so the question is, how can we make sense of all of that data? And because that data is so unique, that data is all of the developers in the world, particularly in the open source world, but not even open source. We've got private repositories. We've got public repositories. And what do we do when we're talking about this much data? And today, I'm not actually going to talk about this much data. I'm going to drill into just a very small amount. I'm going to turn this overall graph, and we're going to drill into, whoopsie. We're going to drill into, you know, one of these things. Maybe we're going to talk about the code as a node in the graph. Okay. Now, this is the obligatory slide. Looks like every other conference outline slide that you've ever seen. But, you know, we got to talk about where we're coming from and where we're going in this talk. And I would be absolutely remiss if I did not thank my colleague, Derek Jadamski, who has been very supportive in this process. He wrote half of the slides that you're going to see today. We worked technically on this project together. Great guy. So, okay. Maybe not. Let's try. Okay. What we're going to talk about today is duplicate code. Now, why would we care about duplicate code? Why would I care if somebody copies and pastes code from somebody else's repository? Let's talk about how much of a problem that actually is, if it's truly a problem at all. Now, this is a paper that was published in 2017, so in computer science parlance, that's actually ancient. But this is looking at how much duplicate code lives on GitHub today. And the colors are a little confusing. I will be the first to point that out. When we're looking at the white color, that's the fraction of code that these guys detected to be duplicate. We're talking something like 93% of JavaScript that exists on GitHub is duplicate. Well, that sounds like a waste of effort. Okay, maybe, you know, these are some sort of constructs that people are using, similar web page formats, whatever. We're talking a lot of duplicate code. And how can we as GitHub help our users? Let's say we say, oh, hey, little Susie or little Johnny in your CS 101 course, I see you're writing a function to calculate cosine. Okay, lots of other people have written this function before. Or maybe you're developing a web page that's got some sort of usual template to it. Aha, I see that you're developing this web page. I hate to get all Microsoft clippy on you here. You know, oh, I see you're writing a letter. Do you want me to help you format that? You know, can we do that? Can we help our users write code just because we know how much duplication is already on our site? So, not all duplicates are the same. Sounds kind of weird, but we actually have all kinds of different types of duplicates out there. We've got kind of like these five different levels of duplicates where they range from type zero, which is a complete copy and paste, 100% identical. And they go all the way down to these type four duplicates, which are syntactically different, but they do the same thing. So I could have one function in Java that does the same function, that does the same thing as another function in Go. The variable names could be totally different, and yet these are duplicates at a semantic level from each other. Detecting type 0, 1, and 2, very easy. Just hashing, good to go. But as you start getting into type 3 and type 4, these start becoming much more complicated to detect. And today we're going to talk about type 3. Now you're going to say, well, what does this have to do with graphs? Your title said graphs. I'm glad you asked. Okay, so let's say I've got these two functions. Okay, these are just little foo and bar, and they look very different, don't they? Or do they? What are they doing? Well, they're doing addition. They're doing some form of addition. Foo takes two variables, adds them together, and returns that value. Bar is just adding one to a variable, but it's still addition. So maybe these things are similar than they might look. Okay, taking you back to your CS 101 days where we started talking about how compilers worked, and we talk about abstract syntax trees, ASTs. This is how code is put together at its most basic building block. And all an AST is a graph. Now, I don't actually expect anybody to be able to read this thing on the top, but this is an AST of some code out there, and it's big, it's huge, okay? I've zoomed in on just a portion of it at the bottom here, just to give you an idea of what we're looking at. But an AST is a graph. So if you put code on GitHub, essentially, you've put a graph on GitHub. And these graphs, we know a lot about them. They're directed, they're acyclic, there's no loops in an AST. There's, of course, loops in code, but when represented as an AST, we know what they look like. Okay, I've got some sort of semantic tool that is showing me the ASTs expressed as JSON of these two functions. That's all well and good, but let's talk about graphs. This is what they look like if I took those two different ASTs and represented them as a graph. Now, I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to bet that 95% of the people in this room, at least, are on some sort of social media. So here's your graph primer. I've got Twitter, where I can follow somebody, but they don't have to follow me. Okay, and that's this directed graph here. So this person is following this person on Twitter. They're not following them back. And I've got Facebook up here. I have to be friended. We are mutually friended, so there's no directionality with that. Okay, that's all we're talking about here. When we're talking about ASTs, we're talking about these directed graphs, but whatever. We're machine learning people. Give me a vector. Give me a matrix. I need to be able to represent this as math. Okay, so that's called an adjacency matrix. And in my adjacency matrix, I've got my actors here, and I say B is followed by A, so I get a 1 there. You know, we just assemble these matrices that take that graph and turn it into something that machine learning people like to be able to crunch on, namely numbers and vectors and stuff like that. But let's take a step back for a sec, okay? What do I have here? I've got rows and I've got columns and I've got zeros and I've got ones. I've got numbers in these rows and columns. To me, I looked at that and I said, whoa, that's an image. Okay, so now I've taken my code and a graph of my code and I've turned it into a pretty picture. This is actually code represented as a picture. This is the AST adjacency matrix for some function. Okay, so I say, well, if I got an image, that means I can do cool neural network stuff on it. So let's have some fun. Let's apply a convolutional neural network to see if we can detect duplicate code in these images. Okay, but how big are they? Well, this is a distribution. There's a nice labeled data set. Machine learning people, we love labeled data. Okay, there's this great one called Big Clone Bench. It's 6.7 million Java files, something like that, all labeled for their type of duplicate. And in this case, we're going to go through, we're going to pick out those type 3 duplicates that we're looking for, which are same language, and they're slightly syntactically different, but semantically identical. So if I look at a distribution of how big these things are, you can see that my number of nodes in the graph, I get some that are greater than 15,000 nodes in that graph. So there's a lot of variability here. And just for this fun little back of the envelope study here, we're going to cut it off at 2,000. We get a vast majority of the codes in that set. OK, so here's what we're going to do. We've got two files in our Big Clone Bench data set that we say, okay, it's labeled to be, these are type 3 duplicates. Okay, and we're going to just compare the two. We're going to create a training set based on those labels of either type 3 or not type 3. So we have a type 3 clone or a negative clone, and we're going to train off of that. So we take our code, we convert it to the AST JSON, which we convert to the adjacency matrix, and then we write some sort of convolutional neural net code to say, are these type 3 duplicates or negative duplicates? That's all we're going to do. It's very straightforward. And we're going to do this at two different levels. We're going to do this at the file level and the function level. So I'm going to compare whole files to say, are these whole files duplicates, or I'm going to compare individual functions. And I'll show you some results of that. I use Keras in case anybody wants to get into the weeds on that. Okay, so these are two different functions, or files, I'm sorry, that are labeled as duplicates. These are type 3 duplicates. Now I look at these things and I'm like, what? But truly, somebody has sat down and they've labeled these things as type 3 duplicates. And so we're going to use these for training our model. And when we do that, there's a certain, you know, very famous Python book on how to do things like CNNs on images. And these are the results that we get. So you see that we get an accuracy on our test set of almost 93%. Using that image that, you know, images like what I showed you before. We trained this on about 5,000 negative clones and about 8,000 type 3 clones. So it's not a huge set. And we're getting this 93% accuracy, and we're getting, you know, 0.2 loss. That's pretty cool. So this is all on the file-to-file comparison. Let's do function-to-function, which is actually probably the more useful thing. You're going to go and you're going to say, I want that cosine function from here, or I want to grab that graphing bit from there. This is what it looks like when you're talking function-to-function, much smaller, right? Doesn't look like much there, right? This is actually type 3 clone, but doesn't look like much there. Okay, so here's the results we get. We actually get better results, 97.7% accuracy. Now, one of the things, you know, one of the standard techniques that you could use to beef up your data set for training, you know, you've seen the famous, is it a cat, is it a dog thing for convolutional neural nets. Now, if I take a picture of a cat and I rotate it, it's still a cat. If I take a picture of a dog and I stretch it or I clip it or something like I blur it a bit, it's still a dog. Not true with ASTs. We can't do that type of image augmentation here to beef up our training set. But, you know, when you're talking about, you know, 28,000 test cases or training cases for negative, you know, you're looking at about 50,000 total training cases, and you're getting 97.7% accuracy. That's pretty fun. Now, the question that you should ask is, how do you know you're not fooling yourself? Okay, all kinds of speakers have talked about this today. What is that point where you say, you know, this black box algorithm has duped me? So to try and prove to myself that I wasn't being duped, I took a whole bunch of these images and I added random noise. Now, I do specifically say I added it because I didn't subtract it, but I added random noise to the tune of about 1%. To my images. And 1% is a pretty fair amount, you know, when you look at these images, because by now you've kind of gotten a feel for their shape. They're symmetric about that diagonal. They're exactly zero on the diagonal. But I've added some noise, and I did that to all of my images, and here's what I get. I see that my test accuracy has gone down. That's good. We expect it to go down when I add noise. Now, I'm not going to say that I've 100% convinced myself. There's all kinds of ways that we could still be fooling ourselves. But it's just one way, a very different way, that we can do graph analytics on code. Okay, so this is the thing I want you to take away, is this is just one dot in that whole, one node in that whole bit of GitHub data. We're drilling down on the code. Okay, so future work. You should be saying to yourself, wow, that's horribly inefficient. In fact, you're right, it's order of n squared. That's terrible. We got to be able to do better than that, which is why this is not in production right now. So how do we find ways to get out of this order n squared modality? And I'm all ears, so if you guys have ideas, you can hit me up afterwards. I'm on the app. You can hit me up on LinkedIn. The next part, obviously, like I said, type 0 through 2, easy hashing solution. Type 3, we've got this. It's fun. We need to keep pushing it. But type 4, okay, this type 4 is like the holy grail in CS land. This is a hot area of research, detecting these duplicate bits of code. So how do we expand this now into, okay, I did this for Java code, that's great, but now I want to compare Java to Haskell. Or, you know, let's get some old languages here. How did they write this function in Forth? Okay, maybe we don't actually want to know. Okay, but then we start backing up, backing into that bigger graph space, okay? Because it's not just the code, it's the users. It's what the users do on the site. It's all of the interactions that we have on the site can be represented as this giant graph. Graph isomorphism, how do you detect similar bits in a graph? All really exciting areas of work. So with that, I am going to bring my talk to a conclusion. I'd like to thank you for putting up with the first talk after lunch. And that's it. Thank you.